Nothing lasts forever, and batteries are no exception. So as popular as lithium-ion tech may be for energy storage, it's not without its weaknesses. Chief amongst them is degradation. You can't expect lithium-ion to operate at peak performance for very long. But what if we could somehow create a battery that didn't degrade, at least for a little while? The China-based contemporary Amperex technology company Limited, better known as CATL, might have done just that. The selling point of its latest battery, the Tenor, is its ability to go 5 years with no power degradation or loss of capacity. But how is that possible? Are we on the way to battery immortality? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark, but more on that later. So where did this magical age-defying battery come from? Well, the Tenor first made its debut at the EES Europe 2024 conference held in Munich earlier this summer. Now, of course, CATL wasn't alone. Other industry giants like Samsung and LG were also present, showcasing their own advanced energy storage systems, or ESSs, and they almost all had one thing in common. They all involved a lithium iron phosphate, or LFP, battery. Now, this is interesting because LFPs aren't some kind of newfangled, cutting-edge material. In fact, we've covered them before. LFPs have been around since at least 1996, and they're a well-understood, tried-and-tested battery formula. LFPs are a kind of lithium-ion battery, like the common nickel-manganese-cobalt, or NMC, chemistry that we see in a lot of EVs. They share most of the same positive qualities that have made NMCs the kings of the battery world. They also have their own little twist. They drop the cobalt from the equation. Now, cobalt is expensive and comes with its own dangers, so ditching this element allows LFPs to be safer, less toxic, and longer lasting than standard NMC batteries. Now, specifically, cobalt's contribution leads to increased chances of thermal runaway. And furthermore, the bond between cobalt and oxygen is not as strong as that of phosphorus and oxygen, meaning an LFP can endure more abuse, like overcharging and heat, than a cobalt-bearing battery. It's also crucial to keep in mind the greater implications of cobalt's supply chain. As with any other critical mineral, it's far from ideal to have a single country or handful of countries producing it. In this case, most of the world's cobalt is centralized in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, giving rise to extreme exploitation in the mining industry to meet ever-increasing demand for commodities like cell phones and EVs. The reason why cobalt is used in the first place, though, is because LFPs come up a little bit short when it comes to energy density, or specific energy, and operating capacity. To compensate for this, they tend to be bulkier than a similarly powerful NMC battery. And for those reasons, NMCs have long been ahead of LFPs in popularity. However, if you're a stationary battery, the extra size and weight isn't a problem. This puts LFPs at an advantage over traditional NMCs. NMCs are already very safe, but when you have hundreds of cells, if not thousands of cells, put together in a battery pack and people relying on them, you want all the safety that you can get. This is why many people are interested in using them in both large-scale and residential energy storage, myself included. Now, these systems are meant to be plug-and-play and modular, allowing for a containerized form of energy storage. Now, typically, an energy storage system, or ESS, consists of a few basic parts, including batteries for energy storage, power electronics and converters for energy transfer, thermal management systems for safety, monitoring systems, and a housing for, well, housing all those systems. Large-scale ESS are big metal containers, usually around 20 feet long. ESSs meant for residential use are, of course, considerably smaller, like in my garage. With renewables on the rise, there's a growing need to store the energy produced. Solar panels in particular are more efficient and affordable than ever before. So it's no wonder that the global energy market tripled in size last year. The world is hungry for renewable energy, and that means we are hungry for ESSs. That's why CATL and other industry giants are investing heavily in LFPs and ESSs. So here's the billion-dollar question. How does the CATL Tenor battery fight off degradation for so long? Well, superficially, the Tenor system looks a lot like Tesla's Megapack. It's a bunch of battery packs housed within a 20-ish foot long metal box intended for grid-scale storage. Of course, the Tenor packs CATL's L-series LFP batteries inside. These batteries collectively have an energy density of 6.25 megawatt hours, which is a fair bit more than the 3.9 megawatt hours of Tesla's Megapacks. Now, according to CATL, this is a 30% improvement in energy density per unit compared to their older model, and it's about 20% smaller too. CATL claims its new Tenor battery system can be cycled daily for 15,000 cycles over 5 years with zero degradation in power and capacity. That's a pretty impressive feat. So what's behind the curtain? Well, before we pull that curtain back, there's another piece of tech that I've been finding super useful for a long time and can really help you in your daily digital life, and that's today's sponsor, Surfshark. I've been using Surfshark for what feels like forever, and I get so much use out of it. I was recently in Canada visiting a wind farm. In fact, I'll be going back to Canada again soon, but I'll talk more about that later. I used Surfshark in my hotel room to make it look like my IP address was back here in the US to stream some TV shows. Surfshark is a fast, easy-to-use VPN full of incredible features that you can install on an unlimited number of devices with one account. But that's not all. Even shopping services will sometimes gate prices based on your location, so you can change your location to make sure you're getting the best deal. They also have add-ons to their VPN service to unlock things like Surfshark Alert, which will let you know if your email or personal details like passwords have been leaked online in a data breach. Now, right now, they're running a special deal. Use my code UNDECIDED to get up to 4 additional months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. As I said, I've been using Surfshark for years, and I love it. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So what's behind CATL's LFP curtain? Well, the secret sauce to their longevity is a combo of biomimetic solid electrolyte interface, or SEI material, and a self-assembling electrolyte. Now, that sounds very complicated, so let's break it down. Now, normally when a lithium metal anode comes into contact with an electrolyte, it spontaneously creates the SEI layer. This is a foundational protective layer that plays a role in a battery's performance and lifespan. If the SEI doesn't form correctly though, it leads to a lot of problems down the line. Chiefly, it can struggle to conduct the lithium ions out of the electrode, which can result in ionic traffic jams, making it easier for dendrites to form. And dendrites are little metal spikes that grow inside the batteries as they charge and discharge. With repeated charge cycles, dendrites can get so big that they actually puncture the battery and cause permanent damage. So ensuring that there's a good SEI layer is critical to making sure that your battery lives long and prospers.
Live long and prosper.
Now, the biomimetic part just means their SEI is mimicking a naturally occurring, and in this case, helpful, type of SEI. Now, while a self-assembling electrolyte technology might have you thinking along the lines of the T1000, it's pretty simple. When these electrolytes contact an anode, they tend to assemble themselves into organized shapes. The term self-assembling simply means a chemical or physical reaction is occurring to form a solid structure in a directed manner. Returning to our highway analogy, this provides convenient roads for the ions to travel, minimizing the traffic jams and the harm that they can cause. Together, these technologies help everything flow like it's supposed to, ensuring long-term stability while minimizing the dangers posed by dendrites, short circuits, and thermal runaway. With their powers combined, these features let the LFPs inside the tenor shrug off wear and tear, or at least for the first 5 years or so of it. If tenor is the real deal, because right now we can only take CATL's word for it, it's the only energy storage solution so far that can be mass-produced while not degrading for the first 5 years. This is potentially a major step forward for energy storage, especially because it's building off of mature battery chemistry. Tenor potentially represents a world where we have to make fewer batteries, all while swapping them out less often. Theoretically, this sands off some of the rougher edges when it comes to integrating renewables into the modern grid and should make getting a return on investment a lot easier. It's also worth noting that CATL and Rolls-Royce recently signed a strategic cooperation agreement in an effort to bring the Tenor systems to the UK and the EU. But before you get too hyped about super long-lasting electric Rolls-Royces, I should clarify that the agreement was signed by the Power Systems Division of Rolls-Royce, who are focused on stationary energy storage and not the luxury cars. Still, the company's backing does bring a certain posh clout to it. While CATL's Tenor system might have been the boldest new LFP on display at EES Europe, it was far from the only one. LG Energy Systems showcased several different sizes of ESS, including a grid-scale giant capable of 3.14 megawatt-hours of storage. LG is expecting to release the system next year, but not much else was revealed about this particular ESS at the moment, so I'm interested in learning more as we get closer to the release date. LG also highlighted their N-Block E, an LFP-based ESS designed for residential use. This ESS debuted last September, but is hitting the market this year. With a small, thin footprint of just 451 by 330 millimeters, which is roughly a foot by a foot and a half, and just a little over 5 feet tall, the ESS should fit easily in a corner or against a wall. It has some other neat features too. Need more capacity? Well, the E-Block works just like a bookcase. Just open the door and pop another module in. It maxes out at 5 modules. That represents a total capacity of 15.5 kilowatt hours. It's supposed to be easy to install too. LG claims a single installer can set it up in as little as 15 minutes. But I'll believe that when I see it though. Meanwhile, Samsung presented its own ESS at InterBattery Showcase at EES Europe. The aptly named Samsung Battery Box 1.5. Not very original, but it's to the point. Now, this used the more common NCA formula, but Samsung is hedging its bets with what the company is calling a two-track strategy, where it's developing both NCA and, you may have guessed it, LFP batteries for the ESS market. Samsung's NMX LFP batteries are supposed to hit the ESS market as early as 2026. And according to their CEO, this is all part of Samsung SDI's plan to become the next global market leader when it comes to ESSs.
I'm playing both sides so that I always come out on top.
Even though CATL, who's a 800-pound gorilla in the battery space and is some serious tough competition, Samsung is off to a good start. It just inked a deal with Next Era Energy, a major green energy and infrastructure company here in the United States. Samsung's set to supply Next Era with 6.3 gigawatt hours of ESS. So if you live in the US, you might be seeing a lot more LFPs in the near future. It would seem the tide is turning towards LFPs. They might be the old dogs, but judging by CATL and others at EES Europe, they're learning some pretty impressive new tricks. And it's hard not to be at least a little excited for that. One of the benefits of age is that these ESSs have all passed the hurdles of commercialization and mass production. We'll have to just wait a little bit to see if they're affordable. Still, the world seems hungry for a better ESS. As the agreement between Rolls-Royce and CATL highlighted, deals are coming together and adoption seems close at hand. And speaking of things that are close at hand, I'm going to be at the Everything Electric Canada show in Vancouver between September 6th and the 8th. I'll be moderating panels on topics like everything you need to know about heat pumps, the impacts of wind, solar, and storage, induction cooking, as well as being on a panel about home energy hacks. It's a fantastic show about, well, everything electric. So batteries, recycling, solar, and much, much more. You can even take test rides in a lot of really cool electric vehicles. If you're interested in going, use my code EEMAT20 to get 20% off show tickets. I'll have a link in the description, and if you do go, be sure to say hi if you see me. But what do you think? Do you think these new LFP advances are gonna be making a dent in our energy storage needs? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined, while we'll be keeping this conversation going. And thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support. I'll see you in the next one.